I back up a lot of data to Amazon Web Services. Unfortunately, AWS can be a super expensive proposition for large amounts of data. I have over 26 terabytes of media. This is a combination of my Plex library, family photos and videos, GeekPub footage, and other random things. Putting that data on Amazon S3 would cost over $600 a month. That's just not a good option. I could put it on Amazon Glacier or Blackblaze for about one quarter of that, but it's still pushing $2,000 a year. So in talking to my brother, he offered to host a Synology at his house that I could replicate over our VPN. If you've not seen my video on VPN between friends and family, you should check that out. So, on to Amazon I went and ordered a new Synology DS1618 Plus 6-bay NAS, four 14TB Seagate Iron Wolf Pro drives, a 10GB capable network card, two sticks of 8GB DDR4, and a dedicated UPS. Okay, so some of you are probably asking right about now, why the 10GB network card when you're going to be syncing this over the internet? Well, that's because I plan to sync this first at home over my 10GB network, so all 26TB will sync over this 10GB card, then I'll take it back out and I'll take it to my brother's house, and from there we only have to sync changes. This will take the initial replication of the Synology down from what could be weeks or months, down to just a few hours or maybe a day. And so that's when we're going to do that. Well, let's get started putting it all together. First, I started by removing the 6 case screws and then removing the cover. This exposes the PCIe slot. I then gently inserted the 10G Tech network card and secured it in place with the latch and screw. Flipping the Synology upside down exposes the memory access panel. Just remove two screws and the panel comes right off. I replaced the factory 4GB card with two 8GB cards. The Synology will complain on first boot that you're not using official Synology RAM, but after clicking OK, everything will function just fine and at half the price of Synology's overpriced RAM. Now, it's time to install the drives. Synology uses screwless mounts, so you just pop these little plastic rails off, insert the drive, and then pop the rails back into place. And just like that, I have four drives ready to go into the new NAS. Just slide them in one at a time and latch the locking lever. Synology makes this super simple. Since I don't have any fiber cables free, I just use this copper 10GB SFP Plus to connect it to my lab switch. And after plugging in the power, the Synology comes to life and is ready to be configured. To configure the Synology, just open a browser and go to find.synology.com. After a few seconds, you'll be presented with a link to connect to your new Synology. Click the Connect button, agree to the legal garbage, and then click the Setup button to start the process. Once the installation of Disk Manager starts, it's a good time to go grab a beer. This will take a few minutes. I've sped up the video to save you some time. After the Synology reboots, you'll be prompted to enter a name for the Synology along with choosing a username and password. You can pretty much click skip on every screen that follows until you land on the DSM desktop. At this point, it's time to open Storage Manager. I just dragged it onto the desktop for future quick access. The first thing you need to do is create a new storage pool. I selected RAID 5 and all the defaults since I'm using all of my drives for this pool. After creating the storage pool, I need to create a volume on the pool. Again, selecting all of the defaults because I'm using the entire storage pool for one volume. After that, the Synology will go to work provisioning all of the disks. With that complete, I took the Synology upstairs, along with the UPS, and sat it on a temporary table in my server closet. I plugged it into a free 10GB port on my Unify XG16, powered on the UPS, and then powered on the Synology. And it's all ready for the initial sync, as soon as the RAID scrubbing finishes, which should complete overnight.
My God precious. Oh, hey. So it's about 16 hours later, and the scrubbing process has complete. So let's walk over to the bench and talk about it. Okay, so as mentioned, it took about 16 hours to complete data scrubbing on this set of disks. Now, that number can vary wildly depending upon which drives you buy, how fast they are, which Synology you bought, what the processor is on it, and there's also settings that you can tweak within the Synology to make it go faster or slower, and I had those set to the absolute limit to go as fast as it possibly could because I wanted to get moving with this project. With that said, a lot of you might be asking, okay, well, can't you go ahead and start the synchronization process before that scrubbing finishes? And the answer is absolutely you can, but I chose not to for a couple of reasons. Number one, I want to make sure these disks are good. I don't want to get, you know, halfway through the replication process only to find out that I've got a bunch of bad sectors on one of these disks and I need to return it and get a new one. The second reason is that scrubbing process takes a lot, even on the lowest settings, it takes a lot of CPU power and it takes a lot of performance away from the device. And so when I do the replication, I want it to run at full speed so I can figure out what the baseline is for this box and tell you guys. And so I wanted to make sure that the box is idle up until the point that we start that replication process. And that's why I did that. And so with all of that, I'll plug it back into the network, power it back up, and we'll install Synology replication services and get the replication started.
To install replication and snapshot services, just go to the package manager and install snapshot replication. This will install both the snapshot service and the replication service all at once. It takes about a minute or so for the Synology to download, install, and start this service. This package should be installed on both the sending and the receiving Synology. I open the app on both Synologies just to make sure everything works and the services are actually started. On the sending Synology, I open the snapshot replication app and click the Create button. On the next screen, I'll click Remote, and then click Next again. Here, I'll enter the DNS name of my new NAS, along with the username and password. I created a special service account for replication that only has access to run this job. Also, in today's world, I would highly recommend you select to enable encryption. Next, we're asked which volume to snapshot to. We only created a single volume, so volume one it is. And then we're asked which shares we want to replicate. I'm going to replicate three folders, my Plex library, my media hold where I do my video editing, and then my general file shares. Next, I need to tell the Synology that we're going to be sending the initial replication over the network rather than over a USB drive, aka SneakerNet. Then here, I select the replication to update on a schedule. I picked every day at 3 a.m. And lastly, I just tell it what time to do the grooming process. I pick 10 a.m. each morning. And after clicking apply and waiting a minute, the initial replication kicks off. After a few seconds, you'll be able to see some basic information on the replication status, including the job percentage complete, the current transfer speed, and the jobs in the queue. If we look at the control panel on the receiving NAS, you'll see all three shares have been created automatically. Back on the sending Synology, if you click on any job and then the info button, you can see all of the details of the replication progress. This is super handy. I averaged about 200 to 300 megabytes per second for most of the copy, but it really slowed down when processing tons of smaller files. And after about 36 hours, the initial replication completed, and you can see all the folders show a success. So with everything all synced up, I loaded up the new Synology and headed over to my brother's house. David quickly got to work unpacking the Synology and getting it all ready to go in its new home. And with all those replicated bits, it looks like it's packed on a few unexpected pounds. He made a spot in his network closet that's a perfect fit, right next to his own Synology. Under the table, he installed a dedicated UPS on this little custom shelf. Neat. And with everything plugged in, we powered on the Synology and let the bits start flowing. Okay, well now I have a copy of all of my data off-site. I feel so much better. There's a few things that I wanted to talk to you about before we end this video. The first one is
A lot of you are probably wondering why I decided to have the Synology replicate at 3 a.m. rather than just continuously replicate. And there's really a couple of good reasons for that. The first one is, most of you who have watched our VPN between friends and family video know that David's internet connection is pretty terrible, at least compared to what most of us have in this area of the United States. And so with that, the last thing I wanted to do was like drop 25 gigs of video that I've been editing on my NAS right in the time that, you know, David's trying to stream Netflix and swamp his bandwidth copying files over. And so if that happens at 3 a.m. when you're asleep, no big deal, no one will even notice. The second reason, though, actually might surprise you, and it's for security reasons. And so let's say that I was to accidentally get some kind of malware that does some kind of ransomware or crypto locker or something like that on my NAS. And if I'm replicating everything immediately, you know, as it changes, then I'm going to immediately start replicating all of that damage off-site. And so not only will my on-site files be locked, so will all of my off-site files. And so if you have them set on a delay, then it gives you plenty of time if something goes seriously wrong to stop that replication before it gets off-site. And so that's the reason that we chose to do that. The other thing that you might ask is, why did I do the memory upgrade if it's just gonna be an off-site replicated Synology and it doesn't really do anything else? And well, there's a couple of reasons. The RAM these days is just incredibly cheap. I think I spent $28 on Amazon for those sticks of RAM. And so kind of why not, right? But also because it gives me the option, and I actually did install it off video, I didn't show it in the video, I actually installed Synology's Virtual Machine Manager, and so I did install Windows 10 and Ubuntu on that servers, or sorry, on that Synology. So now I have the option. Sometimes, you know, the file station manager that's within DSM is just not all that feature rich, and so having a full Windows 10 box or an Ubuntu box that I can use to manipulate files and things like that quickly with scripts or PowerShell or something like that is really nice to have. And so I'll leave those powered off, you know, like 99% of the time, but they're always there if I need them. And so that about wraps up this video. Thank you guys so much for watching. If you want to leave a comment, you can do that below and tell me how I did it all wrong, and I'll see you in the next video.